56 years old, from Reggio Emilia, Italy, president and CEO of Gucci, the Italian fashion brand owned by the luxury group Kering. Marco Bizzarri, you are a towering figure in the fashion world, and not only because you are 2 meters tall, but mostly because under your helm, Gucci has become a more than 8 billion euros company, but which is amazing. But this extraordinary business turnaround tells just one part of the story, because the other part of the story is that together with your creative director, Alessandro Michele, you launched also an aesthetical revolution, a blend of streetwear and luxury wear that has been copied, emulated and imitated across the board. So my first question for you, Marco, is how did you do that? What's Gucci's secret sauce? Or I should say, what's Bizzarri's secret sauce?
I don't think there is any secret sauce, and there is no formula in managing companies, unfortunately. I would love to. The way in which the strategy of Gucci and the aesthetic of Gucci, both from an aesthetic standpoint and from a business standpoint, has been changed is something that has been driven mainly by the passion and the values that we share together with Alessandro. So I think we were quite lucky because we gathered together when the fashion industry was quite sleepy in a way, and there was nobody that really tried to change the way in which things were done. It was very much marketing driven at that time, and the fact that Gucci is such an amazing brand, so well known everywhere in the world, doing the right things bring you to accelerate any kind of possible success. So we shared with Alessandro some ideas in terms of strategy, I mean my ideas of positioning of business strategy, and we gathered together his point of view in terms of aesthetic that was very much thinking on what's happening in the streets. It doesn't mean necessarily doing streetwear. As you said, I think was very much a blend of streetwear and luxury streetwear. Alessandro created a lexicon that was completely unknown and discovered in that specific moment of the fashion industry. But I think the reason of success that was of course accelerated by the heavy use of digital communication, and the storytelling was quite compelling. I think it's been due to the fact that everything was based by our passion, both from an aesthetic and creative standpoint and a business standpoint. What we didn't want to do was to try to do a marketing strategy, because we know that if you do a marketing strategy, even if it's well done, it's going to last for 6 months, 12 months, it cannot last for a long time. Whereas if you follow your passion, if you do something because you like it, then it's much easier for you to build on it and then create on it.
How did you choose him? Was it love at first sight?
I was certainly by chance. I mean, it was certainly not in the list of the potential candidates for the Gucci creative directors. I had a huge list of potential candidates that I had the chance to either meet or decide to call. But I met him because he was a long time part of the team. He was at Gucci at that time for 12 years. So I wanted to understand a little bit more about the process in creative design, and that's the reason why I met him. I didn't know him before, I joined the group in 2005, and he joined the group in 2004, something like that. We never met before. And when I met him for the first time, I fell in love with the person first. Then working together for 2 weeks in trying to define the strategy of Gucci, both from aesthetic and a business standpoint, I realized I was absolutely talented. But frankly, I would have never expected that I was so talented. I mean, it really surprised me.
You talked about passion, but also, is there an emotional formula behind Gucci's success?
There's certainly an emotional formula. I think everything that we built together was all about emotions. And even in the daily life, we tend not to become too bureaucratic or to try to make sure that the corporate vocabulary is too much heavy versus the rest. We always try to follow our instinct, our passion, our guts. We think fashion today, but think always from the very, very first moment when he was born. I think that fashion is about emotion and trying to change the status quo. And to change the status quo, you need to risk. And risking is not an option. I mean, you need to risk it. Otherwise, you're gonna fall down. And also, we would love to do is to try to maintain this kind of trend of success of Gucci for a long time, avoiding this kind of fluctuation typical of any fashion brand, that there are a lot of success at the point they go down. So of course, I could not say that I would expect to grow 40-50% every single year, because it would be unrealistic. But I think that the way in which we build the business is not just an aesthetic or fashion phenomenon. It's very much something super solid that is based certainly on the new aesthetic of Gucci, but also very strong base on business in terms of execution, in terms of new process, new activity that we put together in order to make sure that we can deliver the beautiful product of Alessandro in the right way, at the right moment, in the proper shops, with the right concepts, with the right communication behind, with the right windows. So everything is linked together, and I think we built together a machine in the last 4 years in Gucci that is very, very strong. And the fact that we are so big now, that we can really compete with the biggest player, at a certain point when we started, we were one third of the biggest competitor. Today we are almost at the same level, even if it's a little bit lower, but to me it doesn't make a lot of sense to talk about size at this point. I think the size of Gucci means that we can compete with anybody in terms of potential of investment in communication, either in shops or digital communication. So there's nobody that is scaring us today. So the size means something, because we can really leverage the power of our financial strengths.
We live in the era of big data. Corporations and big companies like yours know very well who the client, the customers are, where they live, who they are, what they spend, and so on. Who is Gucci's customer? And also, there is such a thing as an universal Gucci customer, no matter where he lives, or?
The Gucci customers have changed dramatically in the last 4 to 5 years, because we became heavily dependent from millennials. Because they're wording the lexicon Alessandro is speaking to the new generation, and Generation X as well is the one that is growing the most recently. So we use the big data in terms of understanding how to call client, to attract client, to get the client back into the shops. But the way in which we want to use the data is very much to maintain this kind of unique human touch that Gucci, I think, was able to create in the last 4 years. That starts from the shops, so we don't want to become a kind of a fast fashion driven company where numbers are driving the strategy, but vice versa. So we need to use the data to support our strategy. Our strategy is to make the people at the center of what we do. And that means that, I mean, the human touch, the one-to-one, will remain the most important thing.
So that's why you changed the concept of the stores and
correct.
The customer experience.
Exactly. The concept of the shops was created and thought, thinking about the multi-brand shops of the 70s, where, I mean, especially in the 70s, if you go back to Italy, or especially London, if you think about Biba or these kind of shops, they people were able to interconnect with the product and touching and being part of the total experience. So the idea that we had with Alessandro at the beginning was very much to try to destroy the barriers that were typical of the luxury industry at the time, where we couldn't touch the product because, I mean, sales assistant or client advisor were the only one that were able to present to you the shop in order to maintain this kind of scarcity or exclusivity. In reality, to us, this scarcity, the real luxury is very much the inclusivity that you can experience in our shops. So we created a shop that, in terms of color, textures, experience, and also approach of our people working in the shops, was very much about inclusivity in terms of openness, in terms of happiness and smiling and genuine curiosity versus the client. So to us, this kind of approach was key from the very beginning. We want to maintain it. I think going forward, more and more, the human touch, the human contact will be paramount in succeeding in luxury.
Tell me something about your projects, Gucci Art Lab, Gucci Garden. Is it linked to what you
said? Yeah, absolutely. Gucci Art Lab has been one of the biggest investments, I think, that has been made in Italy in the last few years. It's been 37,000 square meters of space.
It's in Florence, right?
It's in Florence, Candici, where we blended together the product development of shoes and bags. In blending the craftsmanship and the knowledge of the artisan together with the best technology that you can find into the market. And we put together the product development, I think the first experiment in the history of fashion of shoes and bags, in order to make sure that we create synergy between the two. And together with that, we created the schools inside the art lab for different capabilities of people, both for craftsmen, for artisans, for newcomers, for technical abilities, or for people that they have a specific expertise in terms of what to do in terms of product development, to understand what they're working for. And I think the idea behind is to internalize something that was before left to the suppliers, so that the product development is very much a competitive advantage for an industry like ours, for a company like ours. So bringing it inside was able to really create something that is undiscovered in our industry. And Gucci Garden instead is blending together different universes in Florence as well, in Piazza della Signoria, close to Palazzo Vecchio, where we have the shop where we sell unique products that you can find just there. We have a place that where you can experience the past of Gucci, but with the not looking at the past with nostalgia, but really looking at the past with the fresh eyes. That is the Museum of Gucci. And a food experience. We created the Gucci Osteria, supervised by Massimo Bottura, where we are able to create something that is a seamless experience in the Gucci world. I think it's the only case in the entire world where we did the Gucci Garden. I think it makes sense to maintain that as a unique experience. And we did it in Florida because we were born there.
Which are Gucci values and how do you spread them in terms of welfare, workplace, salary, workday?
Gucci values, I mean, the idea from the very beginning was to try to foster creativity through values that are very positive. So respect, happiness, inclusion, diversity, etc. Because we really think that if someone is happy, workplace in general, the productivity is much, much higher. I think creativity foster more in a situation like that. Doesn't mean that it's the only way in which you can foster creativity. I prefer to stay in a place that is happier than the one that is threatening, sad. Is threatening and sad. So that is why it reflects as well the way in which we are, Alessandro and myself. So these values are key, and the success of the, in order to do so, we need to make sure that these the employees, our colleagues, they feel recognized for what they do on a daily life. So it means that all the cafeteria that we do are managed by supervised by a 3-star chef. We have a concierge that is able to take your laundry in the morning, give it back in the afternoon. We do smart working, so one day a week you can work at your home.
Can you hire me?
And then we have a flexible working hours, so you can start if you have a problem to bring your kids to the kindergarten, you can start a little bit later, etc. As long as everybody is responsible. The idea is to give responsibility to our team and our people. We talk a lot about, you know, you need to be part of the decision-making process, so we need to give you the responsibility to take certain decisions in a kind of a freedom within a framework. So the framework is, of course, everybody needs to maintain the promise of the results. But on the other side, we need to give this flexibility. And I think as well, the way in which the new generation are looking at the workplace is very different from the one that we are looking at our generation. So they want to have certain freedom. And as long as the results are not compromised, actually what we are seeing and what we are experiencing with the smart working and the flexible hours, etc., is that the productivity is increasing. So again, it depends a lot from the people that you hire and the people that feel part of a team, and that they feel responsible. I think you can apply that.
Gucci has taken a stand with some programs like such as Equilibrium, Chimes for Change, and the fight for gun control in the US. Why is important for you this taking a stand?
I've been born in an industry or in different companies where, I mean, you couldn't take any political stance. what I think that, especially today, especially the corporations are becoming so big that they have an influence so important that they cannot be neutral anymore. And it doesn't mean to substitute the government, but even if in certain cases the government is not taking stance because they want to please people.
They need to get votes.
They need to get votes, but at the very end, they should not be the reason. Because you get elected to improve your country, and without thinking of what's going to happen next. That is too, again, opportunistic. And because of that, everybody's looking at poll. When they take decision, you never take a decision, because in most of the cases, the population, they don't have the knowledge and the instruments and the information to take decisions. So the government should have the possibility to decide, instead of asking when they don't know what to do, to ask for a referendum. I mean, they are supposed to take a decision for that. So I think for this reason, the corporation, a global organization, they need to take a stance. And we know that we are not going to please everybody. But that is part of the game. I mean, there are other brands that can go somewhere else.
You are the leader of a company whose core business is creativity. But what's more important in your job, creativity or execution?
They're very much part of the same topic. I mean, you can be the most creative person in the world, or most creative company in the world, but if you don't deliver the product at the right time, you don't promote it at the right time, and you don't do the storytelling in the right way, then whatever. So on the other side, if you execute something that is wrong, I mean, it's better if you don't execute. So at the end, I mean, it's part of the same discussion. You need to be very much with a feet in the ground, with your head in the clouds, if you really want to succeed in this business, because I mean, you really need to have a vision, and to have a vision, you need to take a risk always. But then the processes are very important as well. So the daily thing is important.
If you wouldn't have been a CEO, what else would you be?
I don't have a clue. I don't know if I wanted to be a CEO. So I never wanted to be a CEO. It just happened. I just did what I liked.
What or who inspires you?
People close to me, I think François Ripino for sure, because I mean, certainly is a person that is a very solid values in terms of really human values, someone that I really trust. I mean, there's no need of a contact with François Ripino, just shake hands, it's done, he will never try to go against that. A very solid values in terms of environment, sustainability, empowerment of women, etc. That there is always, I was telling you before, that we really care in the group about this, anything that is related to respect people. And then, I mean, people that are inspiring you, there are not so many. I love all these younger generation that they are getting, you know, PhD in so different topics. And I found people 32, 33, they have 3 PhD, one in philosophy, one in engineer, the other in medicine. And I said, this guy are crazy, but they're linking everything together. And they really bring a different way of thinking about education going forward. I think it's shifting a lot in the recent times. And it really is aligning me in a very strong way.
Are you worried that this kind of huge Gucci success won't last?
No. There are things that could worry me. That I mean, that with the health of my kids, or the health of my family, that could worry me, not at the moment. Likely, hopefully, it's going to continue. But I cannot live my life in being worried. I mean, I cannot be, if you're a leader, you need to be in any way optimistic. It doesn't mean to be superficial, it means to be optimistic and giving light to the people working for you with a good energy, right energy. That doesn't mean that necessarily you need to push for 40% increase every single year. It means that, I mean, you need to inspire people and not to create tension, and especially in a business like ours where we sell dreams and we sell happiness, etc. I don't have a problem with sleeping despite the size and the growth of Gucci. I think we are doing everything possible to maintain, I mean, a solid growth. Of course, I control what I can control. If something happens tomorrow on a bigger scale, on a macroeconomic scenario, what can I do? So I cannot be worried about that, because I mean, if it happens, it happens. But I need to be controlling what I can control, and then to control that in the best way possible, making sure that my team is happy with me.
Thank you and good luck.
Thank you very much.